Thank you very much. Well, my name is Douglas McGregor. I'm with Kansas State University, and I'm here to talk with you today about nuclear science, nuclear energy, and the nuclear option in America. I'd like to begin with the fact that the nuclear age began about 60 years ago. Enrico Fermi, with a group of graduate students, developed the first nuclear reactor underneath the University of Chicago's football stadium. Now, this is an American first. The reactor was the first time a man-made nuclear reactor was put together, and Fermi demonstrated that indeed a man-made, controlled, sustained nuclear reaction could be made. Here is Enrico Fermi. To his immediate left is a very important man to the nuclear power program in America. Walter Zinn became the first director of Argonne National Laboratory in 1946. Walter Zinn had a vision that after World War II, he thought there must be a way to use the nuclear energy, the compact extreme energy that is in the atom, that could be used for providing an almost endless supply of inexpensive, clean, and very efficient energy for electric power production in this country. Another American first was on December 20th, 1951, when the first experimental breeder reactor, number one, which is now an historic land site, became the first nuclear reactor to ever generate electric power. Another American first was the launching of the first nuclear submarine, the USS Nautilus. Afterwards, the Nautilus shattered all speed records, underwater endurance records, and was the first ship to ever cross the North Pole underwater. July 17, 1955, Arco, Idaho became the first town to ever be powered completely by nuclear power. Well, let's talk a little bit about what we mean by nuclear power. There are many atoms which are categorized and are called elements. For instance, gold is an element, silver is a different element, uranium is another element. But each element is defined by the fact that it has a certain number of protons, indicated here by the red spheres. All forms of uranium have 92 protons. However, not all forms of uranium have the same number of neutrons. Uranium atoms that have different numbers of neutrons are called isotopes of the same element. There are two main isotopes of uranium. One is uranium-238, which is called so because cumulatively added together the protons and the neutrons, we get 238. Uranium-235, if we add all the neutrons and protons together, we get a total of 235. What this means is that there are three more neutrons in uranium-238 than there are in uranium-235. This physical fact makes a slight amount of difference in the way that these isotopes behave. If a neutron is added to uranium-238, it does not fission. It must have a lot of energy to cause it to fission. However, if we simply add a neutron to uranium-235, it immediately splits into two fission fragments, which releases a lot of heat energy, a lot of gamma rays, and most importantly, more neutrons. It is these neutrons that are released that allow us to have a sustained nuclear reaction. This is the principle of a nuclear chain reaction. A neutron is absorbed into uranium-235, which splits the atom. As a result, more neutrons are released, which go on to split more uranium-235 atoms, which go on to split more uranium-235 atoms. And so the chain reaction continues to grow. The energy that is released from each fission is tremendous. Now, I want to stress the point that this is not enough enrichment to make a weapon out of. In other words, it makes good nuclear fuel for a reactor. However, it is not enough enrichment to make a nuclear weapon. This enrichment must be increased well above 90% in order for it to be weapons-grade uranium. It is not enough to sustain the nuclear action in a nuclear reactor by simply having the uranium in a large form. We must also have something else present, and that is called the moderator. Here you see that if a fission occurs, the neutrons that emerge from the fission are actually very high energy. They're fast neutrons. They have so much energy that it's fairly improbable that they will be reabsorbed by another uranium-235 atom. What we do then is we add a moderator to the mix. And this moderator is in the form of some light atom, such as hydrogen or oxygen or carbon. The hydrogen is in a form of water. And what will happen is that a neutron will bounce off of the water molecules and slow down each time that it hits a water molecule and slow down to the point where now it can be absorbed by another uranium-235 atom. This is a very important point. So the basic reactor design in America for power plants is as follows. It is a steel containment vessel inside which there is water, inside which are many, many tubes, metal tubes, which have small uranium oxide fuel pellets. The fuel we use is in the form of uranium oxide, so it is a ceramic. These fuel pellets are loaded into these tubes, and in between the tubes are what are called control rods. Now, the control rods consist of materials that absorb neutrons, such as boron. There's a reason for this. If we insert the control rods in between the fuel rods, then we can stop the nuclear reaction because the neutrons will be absorbed by the control rods. If we remove the control rods from the reactor, then the reaction can take place and the power level will increase. Now, the size of the fuel pellets in each of these rods is demonstrated here by this mock-up fuel pellet. Now, it's very important for you to understand that this small pellet can release the same amount of energy as 3 52-gallon drums of oil, or 1 ton of coal. So the energy that can be released from a fuel pellet is very compact. And what this means is that since the fuel is compact, the waste products are also very small. Now, how do we produce electricity with a nuclear reactor? There's a lot of energy that's released. What we see here is the reactor vessel, which would be the steel vessel, the reactor core, and the control rods. It is connected to a plumbing loop, a pipe where water can flow through it. And this demonstrates one type of power plant that we make in America. It's called a pressurized water reactor. In this case, the loop is closed and the water can be superheated because it is closed and it's under so much pressure that the water in this can actually be far greater than what you would expect water to be the temperature of if you boil it on your stove in your kitchen. This plumbing loop goes through what is called a steam generator, and it heats water in a second loop, which does produce steam, which goes through a loop, again, spins a turbine, the turbine spins a generator, and the generator produces the electricity. This steam is then condensed in a condenser, which is formed back into liquid water, pumped back into the steam generator where it can be turned to steam again and continue to turn the turbine. Now, it's very important to see the following. First of all, the reactor loop is a closed loop. Therefore, any leaks from the reactor, that is any cladding that may split in the reactor, will keep the radioactive contaminants in this loop, which is separate from the loop that spins the generator, which is also separate from the loop that actually cools the water and recondenses it. The water that goes back to the cooling tower is dumped, and the heat is displaced at the cooling tower. And what you see is water vapor rising from these cooling towers. Now, a lot of times there's a misconception that that is actually smoke or something else coming out of the cooling towers. It is nothing more than water vapor. It is not radioactive water. It is not radioactive smoke. It is simply nothing more than water vapor rising from the heat that is being dumped back at the bottom of the cooling tower. Another type of reactor that is often built in America is the boiling water reactor. Now, this is a little bit simpler design. In this, we have one loop where the water is boiled directly. The steam turns the turbine, which turns the generator, which produces electric power. Again, it is condensed back to liquid water, and in this case goes through a demineralizer to take out any contaminants that have been picked up in the loop, and it is pumped back into the reactor vessel so that it can be boiled again. What is radiation? Well, radiation is the release of energy and particles from a radioactive or a decaying nucleus. That's all it is. The three major forms of radiation are alpha particles, beta particles, and gamma rays. Now, alpha particles are nothing more than helium nuclei. The helium that's used at the circus to blow up the balloon basically is an alpha particle that has attached electrons to it. Alpha particles are highly energetic. However, they're easy to stop and shield from by nothing more than a simple piece of paper. They're very large. They are helium nuclei, and it's easy to filter them by just putting a piece of paper between you and the radioactive source. Beta particles are nothing more than energetic free electrons. They are easily stopped by a piece of aluminum. So if you shield yourself from beta particles, you can use nothing more than a simple piece of aluminum foil. However, gamma rays are highly penetrating, and gamma rays must be shielded from by two main methods. Let me demonstrate the following. This is an antique cup that was picked up at an antique store, and it has uranium glaze on it, uranium oxide glaze. It gives it the orange color. It's also radioactive. If I wish to shield myself from this radioactive cup, I can use something heavy like a piece of lead. This is one of the principles that is used to protect ourselves from harmful radiation. Another system is used is simply stay away from it. Now that may seem simple at first, but the amount of radiation one receives from a radioactive source drops off as the square of the distance. It's not linear. So in other words, if someone were to hold this cup 1 foot away from themselves, and another person would be standing 10 feet away from the cup, the person standing 10 feet away would get 100 times less radiation than the person standing 1 foot away. Another principle of radioactive material is that it decays away. One main thing about radioactive waste and products is that over time they disappear. We can't say the same thing about a lot of other waste products from other industries. Now, it takes the time it takes for one material to decay to half of its original size is called a half-life. Through every half-life, it again decays to half of its previous size. Let me demonstrate. This little model is made of Legos. We're going to call this radioactive substance Legolium. As we see, if this amount of material were to go through one half-life, this much material will have decayed away, leaving behind only this much. The next half-life, this much material would decay away, again leaving behind only this much material. After 10 half-lives, this is all that would be left from the original amount. Radioactive materials decay rapidly, are very radioactive, and they can be dangerous. Radioactive materials that decay very slowly are not nearly as dangerous. So, materials that have short half-lives decay very rapidly, and they give off lots of radiation. But as a result of them decaying rapidly, they're not around very long. So they can decay through many half-lives and disappear rapidly. Materials that have very long half-lives decay very slowly and give off very little radiation. Hence, they are less harmful. At a nuclear power plant, the amount of dose that gets into the environment is taken very seriously. They are regulated stringently, and this is just one example. This is the EPA regulation. This is from 10 CFR, the Code of Federal Regulations, number 50. And what we see here is that it states that for radioactive material above the background in liquid effluents to be released in unrestricted areas, that is, beyond the fence line of the reactor plant, there should not result in an annual dose, yearly dose, to any person from all pathways an exposure in excess of 5 millirem. What this means is that no one person around the fence line of the reactor plant can receive more than 5 millirems per year from liquid effluents from the plant. Furthermore, it goes on to say that radioactive material above background and gaseous effluent cannot receive a yearly dose in excess of 10 millirad in the air or 20 millirad near the ground. So let's make a comparison of what this means. What is a millirad? Well, in dose per year, this is what an average person receives. From the Earth's crust, we get between 23 to 90 millirad. Let's think about that. If we get between 23 to 90 millirad per year from the Earth's crust, then if, in fact, the Earth itself was held to the same standard that the EPA imposes on a nuclear reactor plant, it would be in violation. The food and water we consume give us 40 millirad per year. The air we breathe, we can receive up to 200 millirad just from the radon, natural radon in the air. From outer space, from cosmic rays, between 26 to 53 millirad, depending on the elevation that we live at. When you go to the doctor and get a medical x-ray, it amounts to about 20 millirad. If you watch a lot of television, perhaps 2 millirad, if not so much, a little bit less. Now, this is an interesting point. You will receive more radioactive dose from living near a coal plant than you will from a nuclear plant. That may not seem intuitive at first. But coal plants burn coal, and a lot of pollutants go up through the smokestacks. In that coal are radioactive products. And when it's burned, these radioactive products go up into the air. However, nuclear plants do not have smokestacks, and they do not release pollution into the air in the same manner. So as a result, you actually will get more radiation dose living near a coal plant than you will a nuclear plant. Let's watch this film clip. I'm at the Fermi 2 nuclear power plant. This nuclear power plant supplies electricity to the Detroit area. As you can see behind me, you see the sign to the Fermi plant. Over to the right of me are the cooling towers of the plant. At this moment, we're going to take a radiation measurement here at the fence line to determine whether or not there really is anything here. I have a Geiger counter in my hand. We have it set to the lowest setting possible. As you can see, we're basically not seeing anything at all here at the fence line. What I also brought with me is an antique that I picked up at an antique store. This is Fiesta ware. Let's make a comparison between this antique cup and the fence line here at the reactor plant. As you can see, this antique cup is far more radioactive than the area at the fence line of the reactor plant. The nuclear power industry has worked very hard to keep the dose levels to its workers at a minimum. Over the years, they have improved this. We see here the change in the annual dose received by nuclear power workers over the years. The government allows 5 rem to be received by plant workers. However, at this point, the average dose is less than 0.2 rem per year, meaning that they are 25 times lower than the regulated limit. Another worry that I've noticed people have is nuclear waste. What do we do with it? There are two forms of nuclear waste that are produced in a reactor plant. One is called the transuranic. In this case, it's when a uranium-238 nucleus absorbs a neutron, it turns into a larger atom of neptunium, plutonium, or americium, or another one of the transuranics. These are probably the most well-known. The other form of nuclear waste, as it's called, is uranium-235. When it splits, it produces fission fragments of smaller atoms, which are characteristically known as strontium-90, cesium-137, and a variety of other ones. There are many differences between the two. First of all, some of these products are useful as fuel, as reactor fuel. They're also generally longer-lived half-life materials. The fission products, on the other hand, are generally short-lived reactor waste products. The reactor waste is solid. This is something I want to point out, is that reactor waste is actually solid. It consists of nothing more than these simple fuel pellets. It's not green and gooey. It's not a liquid. So the reactor waste is actually nothing more than the core of the reactor that has been removed from the vessel and displaced elsewhere while the vessel is being refueled. Here's a list of the number of byproducts from a nuclear reactor fuel. And we see here the fission products at the top. We see that the longest lived half-lives are about 30 years and 29 years for cesium-137 and strontium-90. And then we see a list of the transuranics of plutonium and americium and curium below, which have generally longer lived half-lives. And these are the products that we must deal with as what's called nuclear waste. Nuclear waste disposal at this point in time consists of one of these three options. At the top, you see short-term storage, and this is necessary, that when a nuclear reactor core is pulled directly out of a reactor vessel, it is still very hot, not because of nuclear reactions, but because of gamma rays that are being emitted and the radiation that's being emitted from the decaying short-lived products. So a lot of heat is still being given off by the core, even though it's not operating. As a result, it's important to put that spent fuel into a pool of water. The short-lived radioactive byproducts decay away within about a year, and therefore by reducing the total temperature of that reactor core. At this point, it can be removed from the cooling pool, and that steel and the assembly can be put into a steel and concrete container. Now, these containers are designed to last 10,000 years. They've been tested extensively under extreme accident conditions, and these are the containers that would be eventually transported to a national repository for permanent storage. Let's just have a look at this video where you will see the radiator-like looking core being removed from a reactor vessel, and you'll also see some of these tests.
On this surreal parking lot, a few hundred yards from the Prairie Island reactor near Minneapolis, sit five dry casks filled with nuclear waste. Inside each cask are 40 intensely radioactive spent fuel assemblies that have been removed from the core.
As you can see right here, right on the cask, it's about 3 millirem per hour. A cross-country airline flight is going to give you about 5 millirem, and a chest x-ray is in the 30 to 50 millirem.
Oh. The nuclear industry claims their transportation casks will survive any conceivable accident. They've hit them with trains, dropped them from the air onto metal spikes, submersed them underwater, and burned them for hours. The containers survived intact.
There are a lot of allegations from anti-nuclear groups regarding the transport of nuclear fuel. Let's first talk about this. The worst case accident that they claim would be something that's is a name they've dubbed the mobile Chernobyl. That is, the cask would be transported across the country and perhaps it would break open. If a cask were to break open for some unknown reason, then it would just simply be a matter of sealing it back again and shipping it on its way. So where does it go? Well, there's only one geological site in America that's under study right now. It's at Yucca Mountain. The scientific study of Yucca Mountain has been going on for over 20 years. As a matter of fact, by law, the law that Congress passed, by January 31st, 1998, a national repository was supposed to have been opened. However, that law has been broken because we don't have one. And the nuclear fuel, the spent fuel, continues to stack up at the nuclear power plants. A nuclear reactor that we build today at our power plants is only a mimic of what nature has already done. 17 nuclear reactors have been discovered in the country of Gabon, Africa. Here you see a gentleman standing beside one of these fossil reactors. They're no longer active. They played out a long time ago. But they know they're nuclear reactors because the radiation byproducts are present. The reactor was moderated by water trickling through the rock formation. There is enough uranium-235 to sustain the reactor, and as you notice, there is no containment around it, there are no control rods, and the formation is simply right here above the ground. Excavating underneath the natural reactors have not revealed a great deal of leaching of reactive byproducts into the ground. They may find them a few meters deep, and that's it. It hasn't ruined the area, It has not destroyed the ground beneath. Nevertheless, there is still a lot of anti-nuclear sentiment. Now, one of the films that came out a long time ago was the China Syndrome. Let's just look at a small clip from this, and I'd like you to pay very close attention to what is said.
I remember the control room layout. The enunciators they seem concerned with are also in the area of the core water level. I don't know. They might have come close to exposing the core.
If that's true, then we came very close to the China Syndrome.
The what?
If the core is exposed, for whatever reason, the fuel heats beyond core heat tolerance in a matter of minutes. Nothing can stop it. And it melts right down through the bottom of the plant, theoretically, to China. But of course, as soon as it hits groundwater, it blasts into the atmosphere and sends out clouds of radioactivity. The number of people killed would depend on which way the wind is blowing. Render an area the size of Pennsylvania permanently uninhabitable, not to mention the cancer that would show up later.
The person pretending to be a physicist in the film stated that if the core melted, it would go through the containment, theoretically melting all the way to China. Then he went on to say, but instead of doing that, it would probably hit groundwater, explode with radioactive clouds into the air, render a landmass the size of Pennsylvania uninhabitable, and then cause cancer and many deaths. Here we see a book. This is just one of many. It claims to be everyone's guide to nuclear power, but somehow I'm under the impression it might be slightly biased since it says no nukes. On page 38, it states, the nuclear industry has called this accident the China Syndrome because the molten fuel could melt its way through the containment vessel and theoretically keep on going all the way to China. And then they have a cartoon showing a reactor plant, and I suppose that the reactor is melted all the way to China. It's popped out the other side, and Chinese are running away. Let's suppose that you had a shovel and you had lots of time on your hand. Do you think if you shoveled all the way and dug a hole to the center of the earth that you could just keep shoveling to China? Or would you now be digging out? That seems something that a five-year-old could figure out. But then again, don't we already know that the center of the earth is molten? And if it's molten, wouldn't the molten core just mix with that? Well, for that matter, if the center of the earth is already melted and molten, it's larger than a nuclear reactor, I assume, why doesn't it just melt out? Why doesn't it just melt out to the top of the earth, if this theory is supposedly correct? We can think about the fact that if a molten core were on the ground melting, that the moderator is gone. I explained earlier, to sustain the chain reaction, you need a moderator to slow the neutrons down. The water would be gone. The only thing would heat up that core would be the radioactive byproducts now that are still, it would not be the nuclear reaction. And it would melt the ground, the melt would dilute the fuel, and the reaction would stop. In other words, this really isn't possible. Anyone can simply think mildly about it and understand it's not a possible accident. Now on Three Mile Island, this is often used as an example of the problems with nuclear power. I use it as an example of the success of it. Let's have a look at this. On March 28, 1979, Three Mile Island Unit Number 2 underwent a melt. What happened was that one of the steam valves opened up, a release valve opened up, a lot of steam was removed from the pressurized unit, and it lost water. Much like boiling water on your stove, the water disappears over time. The core was exposed, and half the core melted. Now, first of all, the core melted. Now, in the movie, the fellow suggested it would melt through the containment. Well, it didn't. It simply pulled at the bottom of the steel vessel in the water. Second, the reactor had already been shut off. This is often not stated. That reactor was not operating. It instantly shut off when the accident occurred. Now, what's important to also understand is the amount of radiation released in the environment was very little. We cannot say none was released. That would be wrong. There was some released. But the amount that was released amounted to no more than the same as a chest x-ray that you would receive at the doctor's office to any one person near the reactor on the plant site. And when measurements were taken on top of the containment building, the radiation levels were negligible and were at background. The Three Mile Island incident demonstrated the relative safety of our nuclear reactors. In other words, the safety mechanisms worked. The reactor halfway melted, and still no harm came to people, the environment, or any animals in the area. There's another accident that's often talked about, and that's the Chernobyl accident. Now, what you see in the upper left here is the is a picture of unit number 4 at Chernobyl. That is a Russian nuclear reactor. It's quite different than an American reactor. First of all, let's talk about some of the obvious differences. It's a graphite reactor. It's not water-cooled. That's one. This is a solid reactor. It's not water-cooled. Number 2, it doesn't have a steel containment vessel, does it? 3, it doesn't have a secondary concrete bunker. 4, this looks like a building, something like a warehouse. That's not a containment building. It's not a steel rebar reinforced containment building. And I think one of the things that you need to be put into perspective is that this is about the size of a core assembly for an American nuclear reactor by comparison. A Russian reactor is enormous because they're terribly inefficient designs. You see here a man standing underneath a series of cooling pipes that weave through the reactor itself. These cool off the reactor. Much like we have water going through ours all the time, this is how they do this with the graphite reactor. Unfortunately, in March of 1986, they were conducting an experiment. They were conducting an experiment at the end of the fuel cycle of the nuclear reactor. They turned all of the safeties off. They operated the reactor illegally under their own laws. They were violating their own laws. And as a result of this irresponsibility, managed to cause their reactor to undergo a steam explosion, which blew it apart. It's very important to understand that this was not a nuclear explosion, it was a steam explosion. These pipes allowed the steam to expand rapidly, and it blew up much like a boiler would blow up if you had too much pressure inside the boiler. Here we see the result. This is what's left of it. Here you see the round core right here. Here we see the melted core, lots of rebar hanging out. There's no roof. The roof is gone because this is not a containment building. It literally just blew the roof of the building right off. Here are some pictures of the melted core. That's frozen in these pictures, but it melted through and pooled here. And this is called the elephant's foot, as it's been dubbed. Here we see a column of frozen reactor fuel. This is a frozen uranium. We see a frozen river of melted reactor fuel. And I'd have to say that this is one of the worst scenarios for a nuclear accident that's possible. But please notice the following. This reactor had no containment, doesn't have the safety systems that our reactors have, and still, it did not melt through the concrete foundation of the building. There is no China syndrome. It did not even melt through a common basement concrete foundation. It stopped, it pooled, and cooled at the bottom of the building. If you go to websites such as Greenpeace, you'd have an adverse opinion, perhaps, about nuclear power, because here they say, after 10 years, they have this quote, that the Chernobyl catastrophe caused thousands of deaths. It continues to reach into the future to claim new victims, and indeed the specter of another Chernobyl continues to hang over the region. They go on to state that the accident is blamed for the death of 2,500 people, affected millions, displaced thousands of folks. This is what Greenpeace has on their website. However, the official report from the studies made by the European Atomic Energy Association, which is the nuclear energy agency, state the following. They say 31 people died. 137 were treated for acute radiation syndrome. Now, I'm not going to make light of this. The firemen who ran into that building to try to put that fire out were brave men, and they lost their lives because of it. But there were 31 that died. That's quite a little bit less than the thousands that Greenpeace put on their website. So there seems to be some discrepancy here. The report further goes on to say that there were psychological effects. Now, of course, so these people are scared. They've been displaced from their homes, and they don't know what their future is because of a lot of anti-nuclear propaganda has really scared them. There was a real significant increase in the formation of thyroid cancer, mainly in children between the ages of 0 and 5 years old. The main reason this happened is because the Russian government kept this silent and did not distribute iodine medicines that would block the absorption of radioactive iodine into the thyroid. This did not have to happen. Had they been given the iodines that they needed to block the radioactive iodine in the thyroid, they probably would not be seeing this cancer today. But nevertheless, even with this particularly aggressive form of iodine of thyroid cancer, it is not necessarily life-threatening, because the thyroid can be removed and you can live a perfectly normal life. At the very bottom here, we see that they summarize it by saying they don't see any increase in leukemia, congenital abnormalities, or any adverse pregnancy outcomes because of any radiation-induced disease. They also go on to say that in the general public, there will not reveal any significant increase in the incident of cancer. They have not seen statistically an increase in cancer. Let's reflect back to the movie. What did he say would happen? Now here we have a situation where a reactor core melted down, blew the roof of the building off, was burning, was spewing radioactive smoke into the air. This is a terrible scenario. This is about the worst kind of reactor accident you can have. But still, they see no significant increase in incidence of cancer. Let's switch gears and go on to something new. What is our dependency on electric power generation by nuclear means? What is that? In 1970, this is the distribution. We see that about 46% of our electric power was produced by coal. At the same time, we see that nuclear power contributed only 1.4% of our electric power demand. Things have changed since then. In 1999, this is the distribution. Coal is a little bit higher at 52%, but nuclear power provides 20% of our electric power demand. At the same time, the cost of running a nuclear reactor is quite a bit less than other plants. The cost per kilowatt hour to run a nuclear power plant at this point in time is slightly less than 2 cents per kilowatt hour. Despite all of these advantages of nuclear power, that is, compact energy source, relatively small amount of waste byproduct and pollution, low expense to operate, this is the situation at hand now. In 1973, there were 42 orders for nuclear power plant facilities. In 1974, there were 28. Across over here, we see how many cancellations. There were 9 cancellations in 74, 13 in 75, et cetera, et cetera. At the end of it all, there have been 124 cancellations of nuclear power electrical plants since 1974. At this very time, there are 104 operable nuclear power plants in this country. 103 are generating electricity right at this time. So we do really have a large stake in nuclear power. And surprisingly to many people, we are really using a lot of nuclear reactors to generate electricity in this country. But unfortunately, since, as you saw, we're not building any more nuclear power plants, that means that we're not going to be able to replace the nuclear power plants very easily. And this is problematic because a nuclear power plant is commissioned to operate for only 40 years. At the end of a 40-year term, they can apply for a license to continue operating another 20 years, or they may shut down. At the same time, we see that the electric power demand in this country is increasing. We continue to use more and more electric power. We are a growing nation. At the same time, if we start decommissioning our nuclear power plants, this trend is going to go the opposite direction in the near future. We will start to see a drop-off around the year 2010 of our electric generating capacity from nuclear power plants. The point is that we need to start thinking about how are we going to replace these plants. Other countries seem to think nuclear power is a good option. France generates 79% of its electricity by nuclear power plants, and many other countries fall in line. The United States, of these Western countries, is actually lower than the other ones at only 20%. So other countries are using a technology developed in this country far more than we do. Nuclear power plants are fairly clean. They really do not have that many emissions at all, and the emissions that occur are from the formation of the fuel. It's not even an operation of the plant. First, I'd like to show that the coal, oil, and natural gas have a lot of emissions. And a lot of people are very concerned about CO2 emissions. We see that the fossil fuels are the most guilty of producing CO2 emissions. Not only that, but I've seen quoted that as much as 500,000 tons of sulfur go up in the air from a single 1,000 megawatt coal plant per year. Now notice that nuclear falls well under this. The reason why is because there are no smokestacks. You do not have emissions from this into the air from burning the fuel. The fuel is simply the fissioning process. We're not actually burning it. The nuclear power industry is not the only location where nuclear reactors are used to generate electricity and power. The Naval Nuclear Propulsion Program has been using them, as I stated, since the 50s. At this time, the Naval Reactors Program maintains 102 nuclear reactors, which include 55 nuclear-powered attack submarines, 18 nuclear-powered ballistic missile submarines, 9 nuclear-powered aircraft carriers, 4 training and prototype platforms, and 1 deep submergible research submarine. Now what this means is that 40% of our naval combatants use nuclear-powered engines. The nuclear reactor in the ship provides propulsion for the turbines. It also provides electricity for the ship, and also provides for desalination of the water. The entire purpose of the Navy Nuclear Propulsion Program has been to provide safe and effective propulsion for our ships and our naval combatants. After the Navy has executed 5,200 reactor years of service without a reactor accident, nuclear power can be operated and can be used safely. Referring again back to the beginning of the discussion, Walter Zinn had the dream of almost infinite supply of energy. Very few people probably realize, though, that Argonne National Labs actually achieved this. They built and designed what is called the Integral Fast Reactor, and they used the experimental breeder reactor number 2 to demonstrate the principle. This unique facility used liquid sodium cooling, which allowed for efficient heat transfer, much more efficient than water. It produced fuel as it burned it. Indeed, by producing plutonium as it burned uranium, it produced more nuclear fuel, and this is why we could almost run these devices indefinitely. The design allowed us to use 10 to 20% of the nuclear fuel before refueling, rather than only 3 to 4%, which is standard today for power reactors and commercial power reactors. It allowed for easy fuel recycling. The type of fuel was a metal alloy, not an oxide. And as a result of that, they simply plated away, using plating processes, the transuranics, leaving behind the fission products. They did 2 accident scenarios on April 3rd, 1986. And in those accident scenarios, one of them was to cut all the coolant off to the reactor, for instance. The reactor heated up and it shut itself off. However, after 40 years or more of research in this area, here's the reward of Walter Zinn's efforts and people that followed him. The Congress and the President cut off their funding in 1994. The EBR-2 reactor has been dismantled and no longer exists.
The final blow for the IFR came in 1993, when the priority for government became reducing a huge federal deficit. For the first time since the nuclear age began, investment in the new technology was seen as too expensive for something that is not needed today.
We're eliminating programs that are no longer needed, such as nuclear power research and development. We're slashing subsidies and canceling wasteful projects, but many of these programs were justified in their time, and a lot of them are difficult for me to recommend reductions in.
Well, the former president of the United States says we no longer need to perform nuclear research. If the president of the United States and the Congress gives an indication that there's no future in nuclear science. This is what happens. The enrollment in our nuclear engineering programs has dropped dramatically. 10 years ago, we had over 1,400 undergraduates in our programs, and numerous programs across the country. Now we're down to about 550 enrollments, all across the entire country enrolled in nuclear engineering. Furthermore, at one time we had over 65 nuclear reactors at universities across the country. Now we're down to about 26, with three more having announced recently that they're going to close their reactors, which include MIT and the University of Michigan, two of the longest-lasting nuclear engineering programs in our country. If we don't have nuclear engineers, and we're not training new nuclear engineers, who's going to design those submarine reactors? Who's going to maintain our defense reactors? Who's going to maintain the nuclear stockpile that the national labs are responsible for? Who's going to do that? Who's going to continue to run the nuclear reactors that generate 20% of our electricity now? After all, they still have decades of life left on them. Furthermore, you may not know this, but nuclear engineers also design the plasma systems that make microchips, silicon microchips. They're responsible for designing medical imaging systems as well, but they're not being trained because they're not enrolling. This is a consequence of an anti-nuclear program that has seemed to exist in this country for quite some time. There were rolling blackouts across California. At that point in time, a lot of people seemed to come to their senses. They realized that electricity is something they like to have in their homes. As a result, the unpopularity of nuclear science changed from 42% to approval rate to 63% approval rate. Notice in the West that which affected the most, it went from 33% to 63%. The problem is that this is a knee-jerk reaction. You cannot build a nuclear power plant in a matter of 2 or 3 weeks. It takes almost a decade to build it and test it and go through all the systems. If we're going to invest in nuclear power, we need to do it now. We can't wait till the tragedy or the problem is upon us. This was a warning. The blackouts in California were a warning of what's coming. Nevertheless, articles like this began to appear in newspapers. As soon as we see that there is pro-nuclear sentiment in the public, these kind of articles begin to appear. It says, nuclear energy is still too dangerous. And then we have a cartoon of this ugly man coming through the door with Mr. Quick Fix and nuclear waste in a bucket. And then this man goes on to talk about nuclear weapons. I already stated that reactors don't explode as nuclear weapons. They cannot. They're not the same thing. But what's really interesting is this paragraph where it says, but it took what appeared to be an epidemic of cancers and birth defects near U.S. nuclear plants to prompt a recent small-scale resurrection of baby teeth testing here. Let's look at his credentials. Well, Mr. Gash is a cattle farmer. Let's go to what the National Cancer Institute says about it. They say that there showed no general increased risk of death from cancer from people living near 107 U.S. counties containing or closely adjacent to 62 nuclear facilities. The National Cancer Institute goes on to say there was no convincing evidence of any increased risk of death, and that the risk is too small to be detected by the methods used. In other words, it's below the background. So what we have is an article here where somebody talks about nuclear weapons, scares the public, and talks about an epidemic of cancers near nuclear power plants. But if we go directly to the real survey, we find out that the National Cancer Institute, who makes a living discovering and understanding what causes cancer, says they don't see it. This is out-and-out propaganda, ladies and gentlemen, what this cattle farmer has published. Where do we go from here? Well, America's nuclear energy program has been a victim of unfounded fears and misconceptions and purposely false propaganda. The real truth is that nuclear energy provides clean, safe, efficient, and long-lasting energy sources for our growing industries. Now my question is should we abandon something that's an American-made product? This is American technology. We invented it here. We developed it here. Should we let other countries take it? Right now, half of our graduate programs are filled with foreign nationals that are studying nuclear energy and nuclear engineering. They're taking it back to their countries, and their countries seem to take this fairly seriously. How can you help? First, become informed. Become knowledgeable of what nuclear energy really is and what it offers us so that you can refute any propaganda. Contact your local officials, state representatives, and congressional representatives. Write letters to the editors of newspapers. And contact nuclear energy agencies such as the Nuclear Energy Institute and American Nuclear Society for information. Please understand the following. The issues regarding nuclear energy in our country today are mostly political. The misconceptions regarding the nuclear industry have been promoted purposely by an organized effort from the liberal anti-nuclear lobby. They're not scientifically based. If it was based on only science alone, I believe that the American people would readily embrace nuclear energy as a viable option. The John Birch Society has been involved in the distribution of literature, books, and information that have revealed the fact that these very same groups have been attacking other American traditions as well. Our freedoms, our ideals, are under attack, and American people should know about this. I find that the information that is distributed by the John Birch Society very useful, very informative, and very factual. And I would like for you to consider joining this organization. Now, I'd like to thank you for attending the lecture, and I hope that this presentation has been useful to you. Thank you again for your time, and may God bless.